What is this thing? Before 1700, most people thought it's just one, duh, but doubts were slowly creeping in. Then boom, Euler drops the beat, mixing E and I and pi with cosine and sine, bringing solutions up and up and up. Okay, I'll stop. It's now a circle, but not really, both infinite and empty, and it tells a story about numbers and places and stuff. Let's tackle it. I hope you enjoy. Why 1 in particular to an irrational power? Because it takes away the mundane things we already know about powers and lets us focus on the freaky bit. Before Euler, we could reverse the way powers multiply when we apply them one after another, which let us find the general way to deal with fractional powers. We did some fun things with this in my earlier video about elementary functions, where I also promised you we'll tackle irrational powers later. This decomposition into a root and a power does not work for irrational powers, because they're not fractions, that's kind of their whole deal. But Euler's identity sidesteps this issue. The most important aspect of this equality is that it's always potentially a well of infinite solutions. Even the number 1 itself, defined this way, contains a collection of integer multiples of 2π. Now, if we raise that 1 to any power p, the power p joins this multiplier and determines the pace of these infinite steps. For a power of 1, that means we go all the way around the circle once for every k. This is 1 over 2, going half a circle at a time, 1 over 3 a third, and so on. For fractional powers, solutions repeat. And it's the reason why the degree of root and the number of solutions end up being the same thing. With irrational multipliers, this doesn't happen, again, because they are not fractions, they cannot establish a repeating pattern. That causes every solution to miss every other solution on the unit circle. The solution generator keeps going brrrr forever, always dropping new points somewhere in between existing ones. This process starts out very random looking, with no observable pattern, and as we go further, density begins to increase uniformly, tending toward filling all gaps at an equal rate. But no pattern ever emerges, and the circle never gets filled in, not even after infinitely many steps. In fact, the complete set of solutions to 1 to the power of root 2 contains exactly none of the length of the continuous unit circle, even though there is no section of the unit circle you could pick that doesn't contain infinitely many of these solutions. Let's make this more tangible. We're going to use a wheel of cheese to represent the unit circle. We'll be cutting that cheese with a perfect knife that cheese never sticks to, and with it, cut the cheese into 7 identical slices, then those into 7 identical smaller ones, and so on. This is equivalent to raising 1 to 1/7th power repeatedly. The knife didn't remove any of the cheese, so all of it is still there. Now, we systematically generate all fractions between 0 and 1, and cut the cheese at all of those positions. Doesn't matter, the cheese is still there. We could let the knife be guided by the solutions to 1 to root 2, and not only would that not cut away any of the cheese, it would also miss all the cuts made by generating fractions. None of the fractions are multiples of root 2. But wait, we said the knife is perfect. Why are we expecting it to cut the cheese to nothing in the first place? Because we know that if we were to cut the cheese at every real position on the circle, we would have cut it down to nothing. The cheese would have nowhere left to hide. You might already know what I'm hinting at here. Countable and uncountable infinity. As long as we can list the steps we are making systematically, the fact that we are able to do that makes the infinity we're using countable. Integers can be listed, fractions too, and less famously, infinite solutions to an expression like 1 to an irrational power. On a unit circle, which consists of uncountably many points, we get to see different countably infinite sets share that same space without touching one another. Every algebraically independent irrational power will give us yet another one, and all of them will disappear into the greater set, leaving it basically untouched. So where is the cheese hiding? For that, we need to look at the nature of individual numbers, because the definition of a number can also be finite, countably infinite, or uncountably infinite. Integers and fractions have finite definitions, which basically means you can count your way to them. Numbers like root 2 or pi have a countably infinite definition. They each have a step-by-step process to pin them down to arbitrary precision. And this is where it gets interesting, the set of numbers that can be defined as a countably infinite process is itself countable. Note that this isn't a complete set of irrational numbers. It's a set of only those we can compute this way, computable numbers. We'll assign a blackboard capital K to them. For a number to be computable, it's fine if the computation takes forever. It just needs to be possible to write the algorithm with a finite number of symbols. And because the algorithms need to be finite, we can make a big list of such finite algorithms, which is therefore going to be countably infinite. These algorithms will also produce all the usual countably infinite suspects, like integers and fractions, because we can just hard code those in finite algorithms. And we also get most algebraic combinations of finitely and countably infinitely defined numbers. That makes it sound like most irrational numbers form a countable set, but the truth is much weirder. When you take out all computable numbers out of the reals, you haven't really touched them at all. The cheese would have survived all of that completely intact because the size of the reals without computable numbers is the same as the size of the whole set. But going through this process finally lets us define where the cheese is found. The entirety of it is represented by uncomputable numbers. This is the uncountable substance of the reals. And it really is a sort of substance, fundamentally different from all the usual numbers we can define. Think of it like this. Anything computable is a set of steps you need to do to find an exact position in an interval. If you were to mark the segment at every computable location on it, you'd still just make infinitely many notches, and adding up the tiny, but not zero, lengths between them would still give you the length of the whole segment. The actual length, the measure of the segment, is made entirely out of points you cannot position yourself on using any method, not even those that take forever to perform. This gets captured by the definite integral. This is a point, this is another point, we divide the space between them into countably infinitely many segments of this size, which is not zero, add them all up, and get a measure of length of 1. We went one dimension up from points to length by collecting the little patches of uncountably many unaddressable points. It should be clear now why the knife cannot get to the cheese. It's because we can't set it at any of the places where the cheese really is. And the irrational powers? They're just jumbled up integers, laying notches on a circle in a complex plane, a dense cloud of disjoint points with no hope of making it to the next dimension, no way of reaching continuity. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed and learned something new. Check out my other videos floating around here somewhere, and I hope you subscribe if you haven't already. Have a great day. Bye.